educational lecture at Ca' Foscari. Unfortunately, today the rector cannot be here because he's still in a meeting in Rome, but he asked me to welcome Professor Weiss on behalf on his behalf, and so welcome Manfred and welcome everybody. We are extremely fortunate to have with us today our guest speaker, Professor Manfred Weiss. He is currently professor emeritus at the Law School of the J.W. Gate University in Frankfurt, and a faculty member of annual seminars teaching at various universities all over the world. I personally had the pleasure and the honor of meeting Professor Weiss long time ago in Paris during a labor law seminar held by our mutual friend Professor Antoine Lucas, and I was also fortunate enough to attend his lectures, which have always been socially inspired and extremely popular. His writings and methods for study and for teaching labor law have influenced some important European and Italian scholars such as Marco Biaggi, Silvana Sciarra, and other scholars, Italian scholars, as well as certainly being a source of inspiration for me personally. Professor Weiss is renowned in international law circles, as well as being well known for his writing on German and European and international labor and employment law. During his extensive career in labor law, Professor Weiss has contributed greatly to European law, not only as a scholar, but also as a legislator, being involved in the establishment of directives such as those for the European Works Council, and a key figure in drawing up the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. As an assiduous globetrotter, Professor Weiss has been on various missions to countries with low labor standards, such as South Africa, South Korea, and Romania. Moreover, he has been a consultant to the European Commission since 1986 and consultant to different governments abroad, especially in Western Europe, in Eastern Europe, sorry. As we can see, Professor Weiss is extremely committed to the social aspects of industrial relations, as well as to policy making, and is part of a small circle of top-level European jurists who have been dedicated to a project. The project was the building of a Europe that is not only economic, not only market-based, but above all social. This project was implemented above all in the 80s and 1990s, at the time when Jacques Delors was president of the European Commission and laying the groundwork for a European social model. And Professor Weiss played really a key role in striving toward a more socially conscious Europe. And today, in a period, in an era of increasing globalization, deregulation, and economic instability, his work appears to be even more essential. So today, Professor Weiss is going to talk about the future of European labor law, which I'm sure will be extremely thought-provoking and inspiration for all of us. And please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Professor Manfred Weiss.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. First of all, I would like to thank very much the rector of the university and my dear friend Adalberto Perulli for having invited me to give this lecture. It's a great privilege for me not only to give this lecture but to be in this wonderful city of Venice, and I'm really spoiled together with my wife to have such good weather here in Venice. I thank you very much for having arranged this for me. I'll try to not to be too long, because I would like to have afterwards a lively discussion with you, if you are still awake after what I'm going to tell you. Well, the future of the European project to a great extent will depend on the fact whether it can provide social justice throughout the EU. The need for improving the European social dimension, to take up Jacques Delors' well-known formula, as a tool for the people to identify themselves with the European project, has never been more urgent than today. In this context, it is of utmost importance to know whether European labor law can provide conditions which help to promote this ambitious goal. The chapter on solidarity of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the EU guarantees a whole catalogue of fundamental social rights. Among them, for every worker, the right to working conditions with respect to his or her dignity. And according to the latest version of the Treaty of the European Union, I quote, in defining and implementing its policies and activities, the European Union shall take into account requirements linked to the promotion of a high level of employment, the guarantee of adequate social protection, and the fight against social exclusion." End of quote. This sounds very promising. However, if we look into the situation, particularly in the member states of the Eurozone, the assessment turns out to be totally different. In the context of the austerity measures fighting the crisis, mechanisms were developed, leading particularly in the countries in Southern Europe to redundancy of employees, especially of the public sector, to a general reduction of wages and pensions up to a significant extent, to decrease of minimum wages, to deregulation of protective labor and social security standards, and to a dismantling of collective bargaining. This is the result of actual EU policy in cooperation with the International Monetary Fund. There is no need to go into more details of the actual situation in many member states to show a dramatic discrepancy between the actual policy promoted by the EU and the heroic language of the texts of the Charter of Fundamental Rights in the Lisbon Treaty. Therefore, I would like to discuss today whether these texts are mere lip service and what we realistically can expect for the future of labor law in the EU. In order to give a somehow reliable answer to these questions, it's first necessary to provide an account where we stand in European labor law and how we got where we are. Only if we are familiar with the institutional setting and the dynamics of the past and the present of European labor law, we will be able to extend this line of development into the future. Of course, this cannot be done without a certain degree of speculation. The Europeanization of labor law was not on the agenda of the European Economic Community in 1957, when the Rome Treaty was concluded. In its origins, the European project was understood as being primarily an effort to construct a single market. Social policy almost exclusively was left to the member states. The original treaty did not contain legislative powers in this field. But, as we all know, the EU is only entitled to legislate where it is especially empowered to do so. In the meantime, the integration of European labor law has become an important part of the European project. The first steps in this direction, that's important, were made in the 1970s, in spite of the lack of legislative powers of the original treaty in the area of labor law. Directives in this field were passed. They were based on articles in the original treaty which had absolutely nothing to do with labor law and which required unanimous voting in the Council, which in that time was the exclusive body for legislation. This shows that the treaty is more or less irrelevant if there is a consensus of the member states. In reference to minimum labor standards, this was the case until 1979, when Maggie Thatcher came into power in the United Kingdom. In the meantime, the legal framework has changed dramatically, particularly in three respects. First, the legislative procedure has become very different. Secondly, the legislative powers in the area of labor law have been significantly extended. And last but not least, the already mentioned Charter of Fundamental Rights has put social policy on the same footing as other policy areas, in particular economic policy. The legislative procedure has been changed in several ways. As already mentioned, originally only the Council, where the governments in the member states are represented, was the exclusive legislative body. The European Parliament only had to be consulted. It could be more or less neglected because it had no power whatsoever to force the Council to do anything. Now, the Parliament and the Council are also on the same footing. If they disagree, a conciliation procedure is established, which, however, does not guarantee that in the very end a legislative act is passed. But at least one can say that the process now has become much more democratic. Secondly, for many topics, the need for unanimous voting in the Council has been replaced by qualitative majority. This has made possible to pass legislative acts even if one or more countries were against it. For the area of labor law, a specific pattern has been embedded into the legislative process. As we all know, The Commission has the exclusive right to initiate legislation. Normally, it elaborates a proposal and passes it to the legislative bodies. If, however, topics of labor law are at stake, the Commission, before presenting a proposal, first has to consult the social partners on EU level. This is on the trade union side, the European Trade Union Congress, and on the employer side, the two confederations, Business Europe for the private economy and the European Confederation of Enterprises Providing Public Services for the public sector. In the course of these consultations, the social partners can take away the legislative project from the Commission and within 9 months to reach an agreement. Don't ask me why they picked out 9 months. You know, I don't know why they did this. If they fail to reach such an agreement, the Commission proceeds as usual. But if they succeed, the agreement can be turned by the Council into a directive. Unfortunately, the Parliament in such a situation only is informed but has no further power in the legislative process, which I think is no good. The democratic process has been replaced by a corporatist one. However, the social partners, only 3 times in the 90s of last century, reached such an agreement to be turned into a directive on parental leave, on part-time work, and on fixed-term employment. Since that time, they only succeeded to reach an agreement on an amendment to parental leave, which was turned into a directive in 2010. Many other attempts failed. As already mentioned, not only the legislative process has changed, but the powers to legislate were increased step by step. Today, the European Union is empowered to establish minimum standards for practically all aspects of labor law, except pay, the right of association, the right to strike, and the right to look out. Legislation is possible on most of the subject matters, as I already mentioned, by qualitative majority. Finally, after a long and very controversial discussion, the already mentioned Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union was passed in 2000 as a legally non-binding declaration which expressed the consensus of all 15 member states of that time. Now we are 28. The Charter now has become a legally binding part of the Lisbon Treaty. It contains, as I already indicated, a whole set of fundamental social rights, among them the right to protection against unjustified dismissal, the already mentioned right to decent working conditions, the right to collective bargaining and collective action, as well as the right for either workers or their representatives on information and consultation, to just give you an impression of the whole set of these social rights. Let me now briefly show you the impact of this changed legal framework for European labor law. Many directives were passed establishing minimum conditions. The most extended legislation refers to the area of health and safety and to the prohibition of discrimination for all kinds of reasons. Important European inputs refer to working time, to different forms of atypical work, to protection of specific groups of employees, to protection in specific situations as collective dismissals, transfer of undertakings, or protection in case of employers' insolvency, to just mention some examples. On the whole, one can say that the legislation in individual labor law still is accidental and fragmentary. There is no systematic approach yet whatsoever. Many important areas are missing. There is, for example, no law yet on minimum conditions for such burning issues as individual dismissals or for protection of those who are not employees in a strict sense. My friend Peroni knows what I'm talking about. The European legislator has tried to resolve the tension between the freedom of services and social considerations. In the early 90s, construction companies from member states with significantly lower levels of working conditions and labor standards provided their services in high-wage countries. Their employees, of course, remained to be employees with employment relationships in their country of origin, not being covered by the equal treatment principle, which would have to be applied if they would have become workers of the country where the services are performed. Therefore, due to much lower labor costs, these companies were able to offer their services much cheaper than companies in higher wage countries. This led to a substitution effect. Companies in higher wage countries had less work, many of them went into insolvency, and many workers in the construction industry lost their jobs. This led in 1996 to the famous Posting of Workers Directive, according to which essential employment protection standards in the host country, minimum wage, maximum working periods, minimum rest periods, minimum paid holidays, health and safety standards, and so on, are to be applied to posted workers. But I have to insist again, this again applies only to workers in a strict sense. Those who are not workers in a strict sense, and we know how difficult the demarcation line is to draw, they remain outside. And this is something which has to be somehow changed in the future, and we will have to discuss later on whether there is a chance or not. I doubt it. Because we do not have this coverage of those who are not employees in a strict sense, we have situations as, for example, in my country, in Germany. In Germany, people from Eastern European member states are terribly exploited, for example, in slaughterhouses and other places. Therefore, recently, Belgium has brought this scandal to the attention of the European Commission. It will not help very much, but it shows you the problem. Well, even more important, at least in my view, then inputs into individual labor law are the European Union's legislative measures in the area of collective labor law. They shape the interaction and the power relationship between both sides of industry and thereby have an enormous impact on the structure of industrial relations. Of course, here, as I already mentioned, the possibilities of the European legislator were and still are limited. Collective bargaining and industrial action are excluded from the catalogue, as I told you, of legislative powers. The area where the EU has made a significant input is workers' participation. In this respect, the situation in the different member states from the very beginning was characterized by extreme diversity. There were some countries with highly elaborated systems of institutionalized worker participation. Others had very weak systems of information and consultation, and some did not have such systems at all, as for example, United Kingdom or Ireland. The European legislator first has succeeded in establishing a minimum floor of information and consultation throughout all member states, leaving the countries utmost flexibility in how to implement it. Secondly, it has reacted to the fact that in transnationally operating enterprises and groups of enterprises, decisions often are no longer made locally, but by the international headquarters, and therefore it has established on this level a body representing the employees' interests of all the subsidiaries in the different countries in Europe, the so-called European Works Council. And of course, this is close to my heart. I had the privilege to help to elaborate that directive, so don't criticize it. Nowadays, about 1,000 such European Works Councils are in place. They play a crucial role in European industrial relations. And there is one element to be mentioned particularly. In this area of workers' participation, which has become law only recently, which means in the new century. And this is something which has to do with saving transaction costs. Transaction costs, and therefore we have developed a new scheme of company law. The European company. And this European company is an optional pattern which can be chosen by transnationally operating companies instead of national company law. And here again, the European legislator has elaborated a pattern of workers' participation. This time, even including employees' involvement in company boards. Without going into any detail, it may be said that the Europeanization of workers' participation is perhaps the most important achievement of the EU in labor law, in European labor law. It has become a characteristic feature of the so-called European social model, whatever that is. In short, the development of European labor law up to now, at least to a certain extent, can be told as a success story. However, the question which now I will discuss finally is, what are the perspectives for the future? Let's first have a look into the area of legislation. Or put it differently, can we expect more European labor law in a strict sense, more hard law? The question, of course, easily can be denied for the topics which still are excluded from the legislative power of the EU. I repeat, pay, the right of association, the right to strike, and the right of lockouts. Do not be misunderstood. Of course, theoretically, all these topics could be included into the EU legislative power by amendment of the treaty. I'm aware of this. But we also know that the trade unions, they fight for such an inclusion. They point to the fact that these topics are covered by the Charter of Fundamental Rights, and these fundamental rights, according to the Charter, are to be promoted by the European Union. But if the European Union has no power to legislate, it cannot live up to the expectations created by the Charter. In spite of all this very convincing arguments, in my view, it's very unlikely that the treaty will be amended in this direction. This would need a consensus of all 28 member states, which I cannot imagine for the foreseeable future. Therefore, let's take the status quo as a basis and focus on the topics already covered by EU's legislative power. There are many obstacles for further legislation. This is first of all due to the fact that the interests of the member states in the EU of 28 have become so heterogeneous that it is very unlikely to get even a qualified majority for a piece of legislation. It is understandable that low-wage countries want to use lower labor standards and lower protective standards as a competitive advantage in comparison to high-wage countries. Therefore, it may well be doubted whether today it still would be possible to get a majority for the Posted Workers Directive as it was the case in 1996. I don't believe it. The situation will be even more difficult with further enlargements, which are to be expected in the future, in particular with the Balkan states like Serbia, Bosnia, Albania, and Macedonia. They will join the EU sooner or later. There is no alternative to this. You have to be aware of this. But it's not only the conflict of interests between the member states which creates difficulties for legislation in the area of labor law. Perhaps even more important is the fact that the Lisbon Treaty, you all are familiar with the Lisbon Treaty, by a protocol on the application of the principles of subsidiarity and proportionality, has given these principles such an enormous significance that legislation on controversial issues, and labor law issues always are controversial issues, has become almost impossible. Formerly, it was sufficient that the Commission gave reasons to justify why it promoted a specific piece of legislation, and that the principles of subsidiary and proportionality were adequately respected. Now, a new procedure is established by this protocol. Each proposal of legislation has to be presented to the national parliaments at the same time when it is presented to the European bodies of legislation. And within 8 weeks, the national parliaments can declare in written and by giving reasons why in their view the proposal is not compatible with these principles. If at least one third of the votes of the total number of national parliaments reject the proposal because of violation of these principles, the proposal has to be re-examined by the Commission. If the Commission wants to further promote the proposal, a new decision with reasons is necessary. The need for justification by the Commission is even stronger if a majority of the national parliaments has rejected the proposal. It may well be predicted, at least I predict this, and here we are speculating, that national parliaments will be inclined to stress subsidiarity and proportionality, well, to maintain their powers, and that afterwards it will be psychologically extremely difficult for the Commission to overrule a third or even a majority of national parliaments. Therefore, the expectation for legislation in such a controversial area as labor law may be, to a great extent, a futile hope in the future. The protocol definitely is not an instrument to support and promote European integration in the area of labor law, even if we would badly need it. Could the integration of the social partners into the legislative machinery make a difference? I very much doubt it. Of course, if they reach an agreement, the pressure on the Council to turn it into a directive cannot be denied. However, it has to be understood that the social partners, in trying to reach such an agreement, have absolutely no means to put pressure on each other. Formerly we thought, well, there is some pressure, because both sides see that what the Commission wants to do would be even worse for them. And therefore, a colleague who unfortunately died in the meantime, Brian Burkassen, he once talked about bargaining in the shadow of the law. But apparently there's no more sunshine in Europe and no more shadow. Apparently this doesn't work anymore, you know. So there is no pressure. Therefore, these social partners, as I've already told you, have succeeded very seldom in the past, and there is no likelihood that it will be better in the future. Therefore, we should not invest much hope in the legislative potential of the social partners. In short, and without going again into further details, further hard law in the area of labor law realistically cannot be expected from the European legislature, at least not to a significant extent. Therefore, the question to be discussed is the question whether there are alternatives. And I can tell you one thing. In the last few weeks, I met people from the Commission who work in the DG responsible for our problems. You cannot imagine how these people are frustrated. They prepare all kinds of things, knowing there will be no legislation because we can't find any qualified majority or anything else which would help us to get legislation. It must be frustrating to work with. Well, let's look for alternatives. Maybe we find them. Even if there are no European rules on collective bargaining, and even if collective bargaining still is exclusively a matter for the member states, there is no vehicle on the European level. There is what we call the social dialogue, which is even regulated by the treaty. This means that the already mentioned European social partners are not only integrated into the legislative procedure, but have another, perhaps much more important task. They are entitled to conclude so-called voluntary agreements to be implemented, now I quote again the treaty, in accordance with the procedures and practices specific to management and labor in the member states, end of quote. Example for that, such voluntary agreements are the framework agreements on telework of 2002, on stress at the workplace of 2004, on harassment in the workplace of 2006, on violence in the workplace of 2009, and perhaps most important, on inclusive labor markets on 2010. You can already see that these topics of these five framework agreements are not the topics you normally would find in collective agreements. And they are topics where, of course, both sides of industry can agree upon. These agreements, these voluntary framework agreements, are nothing else but an offer for the actors on national scale to give them some guidance and to enrich their imagination. Or to put it differently, they are to be understood as a European input intending better coordination of collective bargaining on national scale by offering ideas on how to cope with specific problems. The national actors are supposed to reflect on the basis of these framework agreements. This implies that the European actors have no choice but to convince the national actors of the advantages of the content of the framework agreements. Only close and continuous communication offers a chance of success. This form of vertical communication is of utmost importance for the growth of real European actors of both sides of industry. A step towards a European collective bargaining system sometime in the future, not in my lifetime, perhaps in yours. There is not only an interprofessional, but also a sectoral social dialogue for the different branches of activity. The structure of the sectoral social dialogue is essentially the same. Here the confederations of trade unions and employers' associations of specific branches of activity are put together. In the meantime, there are social dialogues for 40 sectors. So far, the sectoral social dialogues was not very successful in producing framework agreements. They are still a rarity. The important aspect is that the sectoral dialogue has enormous potential in two ways. First, it may help in an informal way to better coordinate collective bargaining in the member states. And secondly, it may be a helpful setting to improve the vertical dialogue between national and European actors in order to build up a multi-level structure for all the sectors. In short, and to make the point, there is a complex bargaining structure on EU level, but it has neither anything to do with collective bargaining in a strict sense, as we know it in the different member states, nor has it anything to do with hard law. It is rather a sort of soft input which, however, one day might end up in the European collective bargaining system, as I already indicated, but this day is far, far away. However, the social dialogue is not the only alternative strategy. We have to look at other aspects of other alternatives if we want to learn something of the perspective for the future. First of all, the EU, below the level of hard law, has established measures to indirectly influence labor law and industrial relations. A very enlightening example in this context is the European employment policy. By an amendment of the treaty in the late 90s of last century, the so-called Amsterdam Amendment, we always call these amendments according to the places where the treaty was signed, a coordinated strategy for employment policy has been institutionalized. The genuine competence of the member states in this very area remains uncontested. The community is required to contribute to a high level of employment, and I quote again the treaty, by encouraging cooperation between member states and by supporting and, if necessary, complementing their action. It starts by monitoring the employment policies in the member states, and it ends up in annual guidelines issued by the authorities of the European Union. These guidelines, of course, are not legally binding, but they put pressure on the addressed member states. In case of disobedience, they have to justify why they did not follow the guidelines. This arrangement has led to manifold measures and significantly increased the interrelated activities between the member states. However, the results in detail are of less importance in this context to be discussed here. Important is the fact that the chapter on employment establishes a mutual learning process for the EU and the member states, including not only governments, but also trade unions and employers' associations. None of the member states can escape the permanent dialogue and the permanent pressure implied by it. Best practices do not have to be reinvented all the time, but can easily be communicated and imitated. The awareness by the media, fortunately, is growing, even if perhaps not everywhere, and even if perhaps too slowly. The whole structure, to an increasing extent, is understood as a joint European activity. The goal, in spite of the wording of the treaty, is a gradual denationalization and Europeanization of employment policy. In the meantime, a catchword has been invented for such strategies, focusing on mutual learning and benchmarking, the open method of coordination. Nowadays, it plays a decisive role in labor law and labor market policy. Roberto, I'm not sure about how much time I have.
You have time. 10 minutes more.
Okay, fine. Well, the EU has borrowed this mechanism, this method of open coordination, for two projects aimed to reconstruct the labor market and labor law in the EU. The so-called Lisbon Strategy and Europe 2020. You know, the labels are always very nice. The Lisbon Strategy was launched in the turn of the century in 2000. Its objective for the EU was, and now I quote again, and this quote is interesting, to become the most dynamic and competitive knowledge-based economy in the world by 2010, capable of sustainable economic growth with more and better jobs and greater social cohesion and respect for the environment. End of quote. Well, 2010 was already. A whole set of ambitious targets for 2010 were listed up. Among them, targets for employment rates, for full employment in 2010. Do you know about the youth unemployment now in some countries, in the south of Europe, and even in the south of your country? For promotion of the knowledge society for everybody, and for the turn of Europe into a space of research and innovation, to just mention a few out of far too many. However, soon it turned out that the strategy was much too complex, that it was lacking a clear division of tasks between EU and member states, and that there was no really functioning governance structure. Therefore, the strategy was modified and relaunched in 2005. The new approach was more specifically focused on growth and jobs, reducing significantly the number of headline targets. Of great importance were country-specific recommendations, again adopted by the Council. They were meant to help the member states to better realize the objectives of their national reform programs, and of course, the already mentioned open method of coordination as a mutual learning strategy was the underlying philosophy of the whole exercise. The impact of this strategy on growth and jobs is difficult to evaluate. First, it's not easy to simply establish causality between the Lisbon strategy and political results. Monocausal explanations in a multi-causal world are nonsensical. Secondly, the implications by the EU enlargements in 2004 and 2007, turning the EU in a much more heterogeneous community with new economic and social challenges, created a significant obstacle for the success of the Lisbon strategy. And last but not least, the financial crisis starting in 2008 reversed to a significant extent the development until then. The question is whether the goals of the Lisbon agenda were much too ambitious. I think so. More modest goals might be better to promote without creating frustrations which result from non-achievement of targets. However, if you look into the new strategy 2020, what are you finding? Nothing else but a continuation of the Lisbon strategy. You have, again, by far too many very ambitious goals, and the frustration in 2020 will be the same as it was in 2010 with the Lisbon strategy. Taking all these soft law strategies together, the perspective for the future of European labor law do not seem to be very promising. The role of the EU is reduced to be at its best a promoter and coordinator of reform debates. This happens within the member states. Whether this discourse will end up is totally uncertain. However, it would be totally irresponsible of me to leave you with such a pessimistic perspective. In order to show you that there is still hope, I want to use the last minutes to bring in an actor which I totally left out so far: the Court of Justice of the European Union. In the past, this court has proved to be a body supporting and promoting European integration. And it also has played an important role in developing fundamental rights. Already very early in the development of the European community, fundamental rights became an issue. When the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice destroyed any doubts about the supremacy of community law over the law of the member states, the position was questioned, in particular by those states who had a constitution containing fundamental rights, among them Germany and Italy. They were not willing to accept this dogma of supremacy as long as there was no guarantee that the level of fundamental rights as provided by their constitutions would be respected by the community. Since the treaty mainly was focusing on the market freedoms, it was not at all clear what its position was towards fundamental rights. Therefore, the danger of a deconstruction of the platform of fundamental rights on national level could not be excluded. It, however, soon turned out that fears of this kind were unjustified. By referring to the European Convention of Human Rights and to the constitutional traditions of the member states, the European Court of Justice established a jurisdiction which was and still is based on fundamental rights. It has to be stressed that it was first of all the European Court of Justice who established fundamental rights on the EU level. Of course, the court could not develop systematically a comprehensive set of fundamental rights. By necessity, the court's efforts had to be fragmentary and therefore unsatisfactory. This is the reason why the Charter of Fundamental Rights is now so important, by the fact that the Lisbon Treaty has made this charter legally binding. The European Court of Justice is no longer forced to construct fundamental rights by referring to all kinds of international and national sources. The simple recourse to the charter now provides the legitimacy the court needs. And here, of course, the social fundamental rights play an enormous role. The court has shown in the past that it is striking for a fair balance between the still important market freedoms and social considerations. The wording of the treaty until today does not justify exceptions of these market freedoms beyond public policy, safety, or health, in particular not in reference to wages or similar conditions. Nevertheless, the European Court of Justice very early tried to establish a compromise between the market freedoms and the social dimension. This court considered legislation or extended collective agreements on minimum working conditions in the host country in principle as justification to restrict market freedoms if these conditions are necessary and proportionate and are applied to the foreign service provider in a non-discriminatory way. Of course, this was a risky game for the court, but now it's much easier to simply refer to the charter. Now, as I told you in the beginning, the Lisbon Treaty has brought another innovation, which may facilitate the European Court's of Justice task in the future, and which might give the social dimension more weight in its judgments. It may, if I may remind you, according to these articles, the European Union, for all its measures, has to take account of adequate social protection and has to fight social exclusion. In short, thereby the court has a basis in the treaty to give the social dimension more weight than ever before, without being in the danger to lose legitimacy. This new article in connection with the fundamental social rights in the Charter is a solid pillar of orientation for the Court of Justice. Of course, it's uncertain how the court will use this opportunity. However, in view of its attitude in the past, optimism seems to be justified, at least for me. In spite of having confidence in the role of the European Court of Justice, we should not have too many expectations. There will be no far-reaching innovations. This, at least in principle, is none of the court's business. But we can expect that the already existing European labor law will be stabilized and strengthened by taking recourse to the fundamental social rights in the Charter and to the new formula in the treaty. And there will be also a strengthening of existing rights in the member states if they have a link to these fundamental social rights. Let me conclude. Compared to the beginning of the European project, where social policy was not at all on the agenda of the community, much progress has been made up to now. The legal framework has significantly changed, and the European legislator has produced quite remarkable results. However, European labor law still is in a somehow rudimentary stage, remaining a mere fragment. The perspectives for the future are rather mixed. Further legislation, for many reasons, has become more or less unlikely. There are quite a few alternative strategies putting soft pressure on the relevant actors in the member states. The magic formula has become the open method of coordination. Whether this permanent discourse on the long run will have the effect to produce of a floor of labor rights throughout the EU remains to be seen. I have my doubts. For me, the light in the dark is the European Court of Justice, which in view of the Charter of Fundamental Rights and in view of the new framework introduced by the Lisbon Treaty has the possibility to act on a new platform. However, even if the court uses its possibilities to their full extent, this mainly means strengthening the already existing pattern of European labor law. Innovations are rather unlikely. Thank you for your attention.